Good morning, good afternoon, or good evening, depending on from where you're joining us today. Welcome to the ALM Expo 2011 virtual conference. We're broadcasting live from the Better Software Conference here in Orlando, Florida. I'm Francesca Mattu, and I'll be your moderator for today and tomorrow. Joining me is Bob Aiello, who will be interviewing some of the conference speakers. Visit us in the lounge and resource center where you can view these interviews and download additional resources from our sponsors. To view each event, click on the title of the presentation. The webcast can be seen from within each specific web page. At the end of each vendor presentation, we'll be giving away a $50 Amazon gift card. To be eligible to win, watch each web seminar and participate in the chat. We'll announce the winners at the end of each session through the chat. Now, starting in just a minute will be the first ALM Expo broadcast titled Mission Critical Agility. This webcast is brought to you by CM Crossroads and is sponsored by SQA. In a few moments, Jeff Norris will join us to discuss agility. But first, let me go over a few housekeeping details. Our livecast environment is intended to be completely interactive, so you'll have the ability to post your questions at any time during the broadcast or chat with other attendees about the session. We will address audience questions at the conclusion of the webcast during the Q&A period. And if we're unable to get to all of your questions during the presentation, someone will follow up via email. And to ask a question, simply use the live chat window located to the right of the screen under the tab Chat. You can also undock the chat box from the screen using the pop-out button at the bottom right corner of the chat box. That way it doesn't get hidden behind the slides. If you would like to share your thoughts about today's presentation, please use the Facebook tab located to the right of the screen. Log into your account and you will have the ability to share your experience with your friends. You can also share your experience through Twitter. Click on the Twitter tab to the right of the screen and join the conversation. Your tweets will show up in the Twitter role on the right. Make sure to use the hashtag #ALMExpo11. That's #ALMExpo11. Now, if you would like a copy of the presentation materials for today's session, you'll find a button to download a copy of today's presentation on the Links tab at the right of the webcast window. A recording of the entire live broadcast, including Q&A, will be available in about 24 hours at the same location, so you can come back again or recommend it to a friend. Okay, so let me introduce our first speaker who's going to be joining us today. His name is Jeff Norris, and he's coming to us from NASA. At the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory in Pasadena, California, Jeff Norris manages the Planning and Execution Systems section, which is responsible for the software mission control personnel test that command many of the NASA robotic spacecraft, including the Spirit and Opportunity Mars rover, the Cassini-Saturn orbiter, and other missions to destinations throughout the solar system. A driving force behind the use of open source software at NASA, Jeff pioneered an innovative approach to software development that emphasizes teamwork and innovation. Before joining NASA, Jeff researched computer vision technologies at the MIT Artificial Intelligence Laboratory and Next Generation Railroad Control Interfaces at the MIT Media Laboratory. Okay, and now let's go live to Lee Copeland, who is going to introduce our speaker.
All right, I want to now welcome our virtual delegates. There are literally thousands of people around the world who are going to be watching keynotes and other presentations today. And all you folks out there in the virtual world, welcome. Glad to have you here. Sponsored by a number of great companies, and we appreciate their sponsorship so that we can bring the program to people worldwide. All right, that's the end of the announcements. I'm really pleased now to introduce Dr. Jeff Norris of NASA. He's a computer scientist and leads the organization at the NASA Jet Propulsion Laboratory that's responsible for command and control of 15 different missions, including the Mars rover and the Cassini orbiter, which is putting around Saturn. He's also active in human-computer interaction research, a champion for the use of Agile. Received his bachelor's and master's in computer science at MIT. Later, he received his PhD from USC, the recipient of the Lou Allen Award for Excellence in Research and the NASA Software of the Year Award. I'm just really pleased to be able to bring Jeff Norris and his mission, his talk on mission critical agility to you. Let's welcome Jeff.
Thank you, Lee. And good morning and welcome. Really excited to help kick off this conference. Welcome to the virtual participants as well. If any of you are on the West Coast, it's 5:45 in the morning. Go back to sleep. It was 5:45 in the morning where I woke up yesterday, and I'm still very excited to be here to help start this conference talking about mission critical agility, or the importance of having vision, taking risks, and being careful about your commitment even when everything is on the line. Now, you're at the very start of a conference at which you're going to have the opportunity to hear from a lot of brilliant people about agile methods and how you can use them in your workplace and you know, 8 ways to do this or 10 reasons not to do that. And I'm not going to try and do that this morning because honestly, I think that the people who are going to do that do it better than I do. I think they've studied this field longer than I have. And also because if I did, I wouldn't have the time to share with you a couple of really great stories. Inspiring stories about great people who did amazing things and succeeded because, I think, they embodied some of the critical principles of agile thinking. Fundamentals that I think, when I reflect on them, I find quite inspiring and they affect the way that I do my work at NASA. And I hope that when you reflect on these stories that they'll have a similar effect. So, there are 2 stories I'm going to tell today, and then try to bring it together at the end. And we'll have time for questions at the close as well. The first story is about what I think is the first pillar of agile thinking that I want to talk about today, which is vision. The ability to see that which is not, to understand the impact it could have on the world, to bring it into reality. Vision. My story of vision starts at the birth of the internet. So maybe the reason that we're all here, but not with Tim Berners-Lee or with Vint Cerf, but with a monk. A monk. My monk, our monk, is standing in a field in Paris in 1792, and it's a beautiful day. And he's happy for the opportunity to be outside, but he's a little confused because he's been called away from his morning prayers and studies to stand in this field and hold these 2 very heavy iron wires very tightly. He's further confused because 200 of his closest associates and friends have also been called away from their prayers and studies to stand in this field with them, and they're also holding wires. And they kind of make a big loop of monk wire, monk wire, monk wire, monk wire, all the way in a big circle, a big monk network, if you will. So he's confused. He's a little uncomfortable with what's going on, but he's kept his silence because at the beginning and the end of this big monk network is his boss, the abbot Jean-Antoine Nollet. And, you know, he doesn't want to ask impertinent questions, but as abbot Nollet starts to raise his wires over 2 very ominous-looking jars, our dear monk cannot hold his silence any longer, but to no avail, because our monk is an unwitting participant in one of the earliest experiments of electricity. And due to his helpful assistance, the abbot Jean Nollet has learned a couple of very important things about electricity that will prove very important to our first story. First, because every monk jumped and screamed at exactly the same time, electricity, he's discovered, travels very quickly and could be perhaps useful for communication. And second, that if you're in a real tight spot, real pinch, and remember this, a monk makes an excellent voltage detector. So, it would be some time before these early experiments would lead to something even approximating a useful communications device, and it would require the efforts of people like this gentleman, Samuel Morse, as well as Baron Schilling, Carl Gauss, before we could produce the miracle of the telegraph. And you just have to take a moment and recognize how important this invention was to be able to communicate at long distance. And I think Samuel Morse who's credited for at least the creation of the first commercially successful telegraph in the United States. I think he knew it was important because he sent the first long-distance telegraph. And what do you think he sent? What would you send if you had just about 140 characters to send over the first telegraph, something like LOL, OMG, telegraph FDW? Anyway, no, he said, "What hath God wrought?" Very big words, and I think fitting for the enormity of this invention. And I don't think he quite had in mind Facebook and YouTube and everything else that it's brought, but it did presage, I believe, something that we spend a lot of time doing every day, texting, emails, Twitter, and the rest. We're not going to stop with Samuel Morse, though, as interesting of a figure as he is. The telegraph at the time, unfortunately, had a very important problem. First, one issue is that it was dominated by a monopoly in the United States. The Western Union Telegraph Company owned just about every telegraph wire in the country in a stranglehold. Second problem, which Western Union was quite perplexed and upset about, was that the telegraph of the time could send only one message at a time, which that's a pretty serious limitation when you think about it. So forget bandwidth, right? One signal going either way at a time. Now, the Western Union Company had an inkling that maybe this could be overcome, that maybe it was possible to create a multiple telegraph, as they would call it. So they decided, oh, well, we got a good idea. We'll promise vast riches to any inventor, any bright entrepreneur who could come along and create the multiple telegraph for us. And they sponsored many of them directly themselves. And one of the people who got swept up in this excitement and who is the hero of our first story about vision, and I believe an example of an excellent agile thinker, is Alexander Graham Bell, who I'm sure most of you know is credited with the creation of at least the first commercially successful telephone. But he's not there yet. He has a dream about telephones, and we'll come back to that in a second. But he needs money. And I'm sure I certainly did. You may have the impression of Alexander Graham Bell as being this sort of well-to-do, well-educated scientist experimenting in a little shack on the grounds of his estate, you know, taking tea in the morning. That's not Alexander Graham Bell. He is a dirt poor immigrant. He was born in Scotland, moved to Canada, then the United States. At many points in his life, he was struggling to find enough food to eat. And, you know, Plato says that necessity is the mother of invention. This is a great example of that, and I believe it did lead to an agile way of thinking. He wanted very much to get rich, to invent something that would promise him an entry to a higher social station. So he started trying to get involved in this race. But it's important to note that he was the dark horse because he had competition the like of these. Thomas Edison, the Wizard of Menlo Park, already a giant in his field with a proper electronics education. He had been working in the telegraph industry for some time. Elisha Gray, funded directly by the Western Union Company. These were the A-team. These were the people who were likely to win. As I'll show you in a moment here, they didn't have a few things that Alexander Graham Bell did have. One of those things was his father, Alexander Melville Bell. Alexander Melville Bell was an inventor in his own right. He had created a system called visible speech, which was a way to teach deaf people how to speak. So part of the reason why he was passionate about this is that his wife, Alexander Graham Bell's mother, was deaf. And so this system helped a deaf person to understand the phonemes and the shapes of words and vowels to speak more properly. And Alexander Graham Bell's father was very excited about this invention and wanted very much for his son to carry on in the family business and to bring this invention to the world for all the altruistic benefits as well as the financial ones that might follow. Alexander Graham Bell wasn't terribly thrilled about doing that, unfortunately, for his father. But this passion for sound, for hearing and the lack of hearing, permeated the Bell family, and did ultimately lead to his fundamental innovation. But before we get there, Alexander Graham Bell still needs money. That would come from this man, Gardner Hubbard, who had a major grudge to settle with the Western Union Company. Remember the monopoly holders in the telegraph industry. Gardner Hubbard is a well-to-do businessman who wants to create a telegraph company of his own. But he can't, because he's in the world of a monopoly. And I'm sure some of you could probably identify with the challenge of building a company in the world of a monopoly. Alexander Graham Bell met Gardner Hubbard through his daughter, Mabel Hubbard, who was also deaf. And Alexander Graham Bell was getting by, making ends meet, teaching deaf people using some of the techniques that he learned from his father. Gardner Hubbard was surprised and delighted to discover Alexander Graham Bell's interest in telegraphy. And also, very practically speaking, he had very little other choice because the Western Union Company had already snapped up all the good inventors. So he picked up this one, Alexander Graham Bell. Now, I've cheated a little bit here because dear little Mabel Hubbard over there looks very cute in that picture. But that's not actually what she looked like when Alexander Graham Bell met her. She looked like this, which would become a complication. Now, the drama of the final years before the invention of the telephone is thankfully preserved in a series of letters held by the Library of Congress and remarkably digitized and placed online. So if you have the patience, as I did, to pick through these and to try and decipher that handwriting, which I will say, by the way, is practically encryption, okay? Thankfully, some of them have been transcribed by historians, but I soldiered through these letters on your behalf to bring out just some of these critical moments of drama that was in this person's life, the pressure that forced him to agile thinking. I think it's easy to forget the drama that really weighs on the shoulders of people like this when they're forced to make their most important decisions. Let's look at a couple of those letters, transcribed so that they're readable. So, first, his father, remember, wants nothing more than his son to carry forth the legacy of the family. Visible speech. He considers all of his son's inquiries into multiple telegraphs and this telephone thing to be pure folly, distraction, waste of time, and the best thing his son could do would be to sell out, drop all of his interest, and focus on what really matters, teaching the deaf and bringing this invention of his father out. And there's letter after letter just pleading with his son to tell him how he's making progress on his father's invention, and his son is silent, except for his excitement about this crazy idea of a voice traveling down a wire. Come back to that in a moment. Then we have his sponsor, his venture capitalist, who is getting rather frustrated with his prodigal inventor. And in letters like these, is saying again and again, I'm just, you know, not getting what I want out of you. You're off working on this thing of your father's, and you know, you keep talking about this telephone thing, and I'm sick of it. And we know that this drama played out in a series of meetings because they also preserved Mabel Hubbard's diary at the time. And there were these tense meetings that took place at the Gardner Hubbard household where Alexander Graham Bell came back for that all-important, you know, project presentation to the sponsor. What are we going to say? What did we get done? Not, unfortunately, what the sponsor wanted, at least not at the rate that he wanted. And so what are we going to say to make sure we can continue on what we really believe is important? Gardner Hubbard wasn't having it and realizes by this point that Alexander Graham Bell has grown romantically interested in his daughter, something he does not approve of because Gardner Hubbard is at a much higher social station than Alexander Graham Bell. And he's just not too excited about this inventor at this point, who's turning out to be rather unreliable, by the way, because he keeps jumping from thing to thing, getting interested in his daughter. Now, both Gardner and Alexander Graham Bell's father criticize in these letters Alexander's jumping from topic to topic and try this, try that. And when we come to the end of the presentation, I'm going to make this point again, but this was not a problem. This was agility. This was a person who was trying out many different avenues and trying to find the right path to proceed down. It was not a limitation. It was the reason, ultimately, for his success. But believe me, this gentleman and his father did not see it that way. Now, the drama around Mabel Hubbard grew so intense that Gardner went so far as to tell Alexander Graham Bell that he would never see his daughter again unless he focused on the multiple telegraph. And we know this is true because Mabel Hubbard wrote it in her own letters to her friends, literally saying that it had become work on the multiple telegraph or don't see the daughter. Now, reflect with me for a moment on the pressure that is felt by this great individual at this moment. First, we have his father and the very powerful impulse to honor your parents' legacy, to please them. Also, there's an altruistic goal here, to teach the deaf. This sounds very noble. But Alexander is motivated in part by trying to reach a higher social station, and the only path to that is right now through Gardner Hubbard. Gardner Hubbard, who has set as a precondition that he focus only on what he is interested in, or he loses the third most important thing in his life, the woman that he loves. Now, the talk is called Mission Critical Agility, which I know to most people means that you might crash a spacecraft if you mess it up, and I'm coming to that in the next section of the talk. But when you think about what this person had on the line and what other great inventors and entrepreneurs have on the line in their moment of discovery, this is mission critical too. This is losing everything you want or gaining it all on the moment of a decision. All three of these people, the most important people in Alexander Graham Bell's life, are telling him to focus on anything but the telephone. So what does he do? What would you do if that much was on the line? He can't be dissuaded from this idea. It consumes him almost literally. He works himself to the brink of death on multiple occasions. But he succeeds, and he invents the telephone, and he creates a legacy that has traveled all the way to what we have in our pocket today. Now, here we have Alexander Graham Bell holding an early prototype of his device, but I have to point out that he's holding it entirely incorrectly, and if you hold your phone this way, it will cause signal loss. And the manufacturer cannot be held responsible for dropped calls, so please don't hold your phone this way. Now, I think it's easy to look at Alexander Graham Bell in this situation and get the impression that he has superhuman vision, just, you know, that he could look through all of those pressures and still stay focused and create this amazing thing. But just in case you think he's some kind of superhero, he was laboring to at least some extent on a major misconception. This is an astonishing story. Alexander Graham Bell, when he was younger and starting his inquiries into these kinds of devices, got a hold of a book written by Helmholtz, a German scientist who did many of the early experiments on electricity and sound. And it was written in German, and Alexander Graham Bell didn't read German. But he looked at the pictures and tried to puzzle out some of the words. Couldn't run it through Google Translate, I'm afraid. But he thought he understood what was going on. And what he thought was that Helmholtz had successfully sent the sounds of vowels through a wire, or parts of speech, right? So Alexander Graham Bell looks at that and says, well, gosh, if Helmholtz can do that, surely I can do the rest of speech, right? Helmholtz had done nothing of the kind. And for many years, Alexander Graham Bell was laboring to reproduce an experiment that had never actually been accomplished. Many years later, when Alexander Graham Bell got a hold of a French translation of the book, he realized to his astonishment that Helmholtz had not done this, but Alexander Graham Bell had done that. He reproduced the experiment that never happened, and then went on to create the telephone. And I think it tells you something about vision in that story, which is that if somehow we could just overcome, even artificially for a moment, our preconception of what is possible and not possible, that our true vision shines forward the way it did with Alexander Graham Bell. So I find that just inspiring. Now, we've created a telephone. Alexander Graham Bell's created a telephone, but it is not a commercial success yet. Very few people know about it. And there is a grand opportunity awaiting Alexander Graham Bell that he is about to completely miss. And it is in this part of the story, I want to draw your attention to a different kind of vision and agile thinking, different from what we see in Alexander Graham Bell. See, there's this thing called the World's Fair, the Centennial Exposition, for the first time being held in the United States in Philadelphia. This is a major event for the time. One of the things that happens at these World's Fairs is that marvels of invention are shown to the world, and investors and you know, dignitaries are given an opportunity to consider supporting them. Now, Alexander Graham Bell made arrangements to bring his father's invention to the fair, but couldn't be troubled to go there himself and bring his telephone to demonstrate it. It took Mabel Hubbard, his fiance, to fix this. Mabel understood the opportunity that the World's Fair offered Alexander and his invention, saw the critical moment. And what she did, true story, all of this is a true story, of course, she packed a bag with his telephone and a change of clothes and put it in a carriage and drove to where he taught and said, you know what, we're going to go for a pleasure drive in the country. Hop in. And he said, well, okay, you know, done with my classes, I guess we'll do this. And so off they go on this pleasure drive. And then he's very shocked to find himself standing at a train station holding his bag in one hand and a ticket in the other, and his wife is turning and walking away from him. And he protests, I can't go to Philadelphia. I have my teaching. I have other things I have to be doing right now. And she says, no, you must do this, and turns her back. Mabel Hubbard is deaf. She communicates by reading lips. When she turns her back, she cannot quite literally hear his pleas, his disagreements. So he dejectedly turns, climbs aboard this train, and travels to Philadelphia. He presents his telephone, and it becomes a sensation, the talk of the world. Major investment is recruited. It realizes its potential in that moment, and it took the vision of Mabel Hubbard to make that happen. Mabel Bell, because they did get married, would continue to serve that responsibility in the Bell Telephone Company for some time. And I'll just also mention, went on to become one of the pioneers of aviation as well. Mabel Hubbard, a deaf woman, was known by many as the First Lady of Canadian Aviation. She's a remarkable woman, probably deserves a talk all by herself. But we, sadly, must go on to now an unfortunate story of a lack of vision within this greater saga. The telephone is invented. It's patented. It is the sensation of the world. I'll mention, by the way, Alexander Graham Bell had the patents, but if you think any of you have patent trouble, he defended his patents successfully 500 times in courts over the next 30, 40 years. So you don't have patent problems. He has patent problems. The Western Union Telegraph Company is still around. It's still a behemoth. It's still actually trying to invent the multiple telegraph. Gardner Hubbard, remember, he's the investor, the venture capitalist, he gets a little bit of cold feet for a moment here. And he goes and he visits William Orton, the president of the Western Union Company at the time, and he presents him with the working telephone and all of the patents and says, you can buy this. The Western Union Company can own all of the rights to the telephone for the sum of $100,000, which in today's currency would be just under $3 million. He offered the telephone to the Western Union Company for $3 million. The Western Union Telegraph Company turned him down. William Orton turned him down. It's possible that he was still so focused on the multiple telegraph that he couldn't see the potential in the device before him. It's possible that he still had a grudge against Gardner Hubbard for the difference that they had. But for whatever reason, this failure, this lack of vision, has forever immortalized William Orton, not as the president of one of the most influential companies of the time, but as the man who probably made one of the single worst business decisions in history, which is a sad thing. Just 2 years later, just an eye blink, William Orton said publicly that he would consider it a bargain if he could purchase all of the rights to the telephone for 20 times the sum that had been offered to him. But by this point, I'm afraid the Bell Telephone Company was not selling. It was on its way to dwarf the impact that Western Union would ever have on the world. That is a story of a lack, a stunning lack of vision. We're coming to the end of our first story about agile thinking and vision and the importance of it. And I want to draw your attention back to the different kinds of vision that I talked about in this story. First, we have the obvious vision of the inventor, Alexander Graham Bell, a kind of vision I think we all wish we had, the ability to create out of nothing something so important. But thankfully for us, we do not all have to be genius inventors in order to create great things. In fact, if we were, we would be failures, because Alexander Graham Bell on his own did not have the vision necessary to bring his invention to the world. That required the invention of other people and the vision of other people. So first, let's talk a little bit about Gardner Hubbard. He grudgingly permitted investigation into the margins of the creation of the multiple telegraph. And I think that this is a great lesson for all those in this audience who are leaders of people, that you must strike a balance, especially on an agile thinking team, between keeping an eye on the goal and tolerating exploration in the margins. And it's a concern, I think, that some of us may have with our favorite agile methods, because they promote so much visibility and so much awareness of what's going on, that we have to be careful that in all of those bright lights shining on everything that's happening, that it's still allowed for people to follow up, to some extent, what could be the next telephone. Gardner Hubbard did. Alexander Graham Bell's father also had vision, but it was in a narrow area, in a somewhat intolerant way. But we can forgive him that. And then Mabel Hubbard, the vision of a person who understood the impact and the opportunity that the telephone represented, and then brought it to market by helping Alexander seize upon the appropriate moment. Now, it may be tempting to look at these people and say, this is an amazing story, but people aren't like this anymore. The world is different. It's more complicated. These people don't exist anymore, but of course they do. And despite what you may think about individuals like these two, these are visionaries of our time. We call them entrepreneurs. They understand the kinds of impact that things that don't exist have on the world. They surround themselves with people who complement their vision. Vision becomes an equally important characteristic in their workforce, along with the rest of the qualifications that we all very commonly recognize. Now, if you find this particular story as captivating as I do, I heartily recommend this book written by Charlotte Gray, Reluctant Genius. It is a great essay of Alexander Graham Bell's life. There's much more. I could only tell you a part of this amazing story, more that happened before, more that happened later. So I encourage you to think about reading that. But I sadly must go on to our next story, because vision is not the only pillar of agile thinking that I want to talk about today. The next one, which lands very close to home for me, is risk. The willingness to take and tolerate risk in our work is a key pillar in agile thinking. And at no point do I think did we feel this more palpably at NASA than in a moment I'm going to show in a second. But I just first want to say that I work for NASA, and I think that we embrace and understand risk in a very special way. The things we do are risky, and we've developed risk into a currency that is traded against all of the other currencies of our projects: power, cost, schedule, and risk. are all equal citizens in our pocketbook. I think at no other point did we feel that price of risk more palpably than in this moment where this great person
in this decade and do the other things, not because they are easy,
said
but
these
because
things,
they are hard.
And challenged
because
us to reach
will serve
the moon
to organize
in less than 10 years
the best
through the Apollo program.
Energies and skills, because
and
that challenge is one that we're willing to accept, one we are unwilling to postpone, and one we intend to win, and the others too.
Now, it's funny. When John F. Kennedy made those really inspiring statements of we choose to go to the moon not because it's easy, not because it's hard, not because it's easy, but because it is hard, he kind of left out the next part, which was how in the world to do that. And I don't think it's an exaggeration to suggest that NASA didn't know how to do that. Not yet. So where would they look for inspiration? Where do scientists and engineers look for inspiration? Well, they look to a lot of places. One of them is science fiction. And so it turns out that the first design for going to the moon looked suspiciously like this. Destination Moon, a 1950s movie. And the vision for lunar exploration that is played out in this movie, quite humorously at times, is a very compelling one. It's sort of the way that if you asked your five-year-old how to go to the moon, it's what they would probably say. They would say, well, I'm going to build a giant rocket. That's a good start. How big? Really big. Then I'm going to launch it to the moon and then land it on the moon and get out and do whatever you do on the moon and then get back in that gigantic rocket and fly it home. Sounds great, right? Sounds reasonable. What could be simpler? What could have a lower risk than doing that? So it's not surprising that that was the first design for Apollo, and it persisted for some time. It was called the direct ascent method. Now, in the direct ascent method, it began with the idea of constructing a gigantic rocket. It's called Nova. Enormous, far larger than the rocket that we would ultimately build, the Saturn V. And since we're in Florida, I think that I should share this little anecdote, which is that the rocket that we did ultimately use, the Saturn V, at the time of the launches of Apollo, was the tallest building in Florida. Technically, there was one larger building, which you can go see today still, and that was the building that held the Saturn V. But the Saturn V was rolled down a road on wheels and then launched into space. They launched the largest building in Florida into space. I mean, come on. I think that's great. But the Nova rocket was going to be even bigger. And I'll even mention that that thing you see on the left there, which was supposed to land on the moon, itself was 6 stories tall. I like to call this the Battlestar Galactica method of lunar exploration. It had to be enormous because it was everything. It was the craft that would travel to the moon. It was the craft that would land on the moon, gather your stuff, launch again. It did atmospheric reentry. It did everything. So it was huge. Had to be enormous. Unfortunately, it was too large to succeed. However, it was endorsed by some great thinkers of the time, including this man, I have a lot of respect for, Wernher von Braun, recognized by many at the time as probably the best thinker in rocketry. And he endorsed the direct ascent method publicly, strongly. There was a small vocal minority that disagreed, that had a different idea, and they were led by the second hero today, John C. Haubelt. He had a very different idea. Instead of constructing a giant rocket that would launch to the moon and then launch back, instead of that very simple concept, he said, you know what? Better idea. We're going to make 4 spacecraft, and they're going to reconfigure multiple times during flight in space on the way to the moon and then reconfigure on the way back again. And that's how we're going to get to the moon and back. And even by today's standards, if you read the design of the Apollo mission, it sounds like science fiction. I want you to try and imagine what it sounded like to someone in 1960. So now here is John describing his lunar orbit rendezvous method, I think quite effectively using the tried and true technology of a chalkboard. This is a great technology, the chalkboard, one that could not possibly break and fail while I'm standing in front of multiple hundreds of people and who knows how many out there in cyberspace, but I don't know that I would be taken terribly seriously about the importance of risk if I didn't take a couple risks myself. So instead of using a chalkboard, I'm going to use a pile of technologies that is only barely tested, that I hacked together, to explain the same idea. And you know what? I want to take this moment to point out the lovely art of live demos, something which I'm afraid has gotten a bad name, and everybody's always telling you, oh, don't ever do a live demo, not in front of a big audience, right? Those people are weak. So in any case, it's going to be entertaining for you, right? Because if I mess up here, it's still fun, right? All right, so let's do this. Apollo, mission design, augmented reality style. So excuse me while I take a seat here. You want to go, actually, you want to send just a big hunk of metal from this place to this place. And that in itself is already kind of a hard thing to contemplate doing because those are pretty far apart. But to make things worse, you want to stick people inside the chunk of metal. And yes, they need to survive and make it back again. How in the world are you going to do that? Well, we've already established that Battlestar Galactica is not the way we want to go. So let's think about simplicity a different way. What is the smallest and simplest thing we could possibly cram three very brave people into? It turns out that is probably this, which is the Apollo command module. A very modest and simple spacecraft, especially when you put it up against that six-story behemoth we were talking about earlier. But it's got some important parts. I mean, you just saw the door. Well, here, I'm bringing the door back. It's got a door there that you can climb in and out. The astronauts climb through that door only twice, by the way, once at the beginning of the mission in order to get in, and once at the very end of the mission where we hope it's floating in the water. But that's the only thing that door is for. It doesn't have a whole lot more to it. Yes, it has computers in it if you are very, very liberal in your definition of what a computer is. And it had software if you think that wrapping wires around things consists of software. But nonetheless, we'll skip over that for a moment. Just take a look at this and recognize, however, that this is not going to get you to the moon. It's missing a rather important part, and I bet you if you asked your son or daughter, they would probably say, Mommy, Daddy, it needs an engine. So that comes from here. This is the Apollo service module. So there's our engine finally. And I'll point out that this thing, as cool as it is, it's unpressurized. So they're just consumables and things like that in this part of the spacecraft. So the astronauts, as much as they might like to have just a little more square footage, do not get to go in this part. But it docks on to the back of the command module just like that. So that looks kind of cool, right? That looks like something you might see in Destination Moon, one of those 1950s movies. This is a spacecraft which would, you know, looks like something that could get you there, right? It, however, is not going to land on the moon. And you're not just trying to get to the moon. You want to land there, and you want to get out, and you want to come back again. So for that, we're going to need a true spacecraft, something quite exotic looking. Something like this. There. The Apollo Lunar Module. Now this is a spacecraft. Look at those spindly legs, all those hard corners and edges. This thing would melt in an atmosphere. It has no business being in the air, but turns out it works quite well in the world of low gravity and on a place like the moon. It gets nestled in right behind the service module and the command module like that, and the Saturn V launch shroud wraps kind of over to the top of this. So this whole thing here is in the stack on the top of that rocket, ludicrously small, by the way, compared to the behemoth that sits beneath it. Now, we need to take a moment here and step back and think about how John Howbolt's presentation is going right about now. Because I want you to think of the fact that just before him, a guy stood up and said, I know how we're going to go to the moon. We're going to, you know, wait for this. We're going to build a giant rocket. We're going to fly it to the moon and then launch it again and fly it back again. Any questions? Any questions? And then John stands up and says this. And I'm sure at this moment people were starting to maybe roll their eyes a little bit, look at the door, check their watches. Maybe one of them would have said, you know, John, it's really nice of you to put in all this effort and come all the way down here for us today. But, you know, me and the guys were talking here, and just one issue of several that we'd like to point out with your design is that there's this rocket engine thing you told us about here. If you turn that thing on, we're pretty sure it's going to have a bad effect on this part. And John says, didn't explain. After we launch the spacecraft, we're going to, you know, fly this thing out and turn it around again and dock it right back in like that, in space. I think he probably just plowed on at that point, which is sometimes a good idea, because what we've got here is quite a contraption. This is the configuration of the spacecraft as it flew to the moon. So you have to pardon me here. We have to have a little theatrics for a moment. So, whoop. Here we have the Earth receding in the distance. And we have the moon arriving. We're there. We're there, but we need to land. We're not done yet. Well, no problem, says John. Yeah, that thing looks like it might have a little trouble going down all in one piece, but that's why we can break it apart. So what we're going to do is, first, a couple astronauts are going to climb from this part here into that part, leaving one guy behind, and this part's going to separate and fly off, and it, fellow that's in there gets to do science in orbit around the moon, which I think we're all going to have to agree has to be something of a minor disappointment. Because the other guys get to climb inside the sports car and pilot it down. You know, they got to go manual just before they land. Just funny side note, which is that every Apollo astronaut that landed on the moon went manual before they landed. And you have to ask yourself, wouldn't you? The spacecraft was quite capable, by the way, of landing on its own, but every one of them said, I'm sorry, I got to take this manual. There you go. So they did land it, and then they got out, and they walked around. They gathered up their moon rocks. They climbed back inside, and then the thing lifts off. But, wait, no. It breaks in half, and the top part lifts off because this part's too heavy. So this stays on the ground, stays on the moon, and just this little thing flies around and somehow locates again that thing and redocks. Two astronauts climb out of here carrying all of their shopping bags full of moon rocks, and they say, hey, how's it been up here? And the guy says, kind of boring. Thanks for asking. Anyway, so they're done with this part now. They don't need to bring this back home. So they release this, and they crash it into the moon. And they make a giant hole for science. True. Now we got just this little guy, right? So, more theater here. We're at the moon. The moon recedes into the distance. And we're back home again. And still not done yet. I hope someone was still listening when John said this, because then he said, well, we can't land this whole thing either, so we're going to discard the service module. So this part floats off, burns up to its demise, and then we're left just with this. from the largest building in Florida down to that, which slowly, gently floats down, not so gently, and splashes down in the ocean, and three very scared astronauts climb out, very, very happy to be alive. The end. So, I'm going to bring that back for you now. We're going to talk about it. Whoops. Okay. This does not look like a low-risk system. It is not how your five-year-old would describe going to the moon. It was not how Wernher von Braun envisioned going to the moon. But nonetheless, with the benefit of a great deal of time and lots more science after the fact, historians have studied this design in great detail. And they tell us that this was the defining moment of Apollo, that this is the reason why we got to the moon. And that if it weren't for this design, we certainly wouldn't have gotten there in the 10 years that we had promised. We maybe wouldn't have gotten there at all. So it's interesting. This design, which still sounds a little bit nuts, was the lowest risk thing that could be done. Sort of turns preconceptions of complexity and risk a little bit on their head. Now, I'm not done. Not done with this story. I am done with my demo. So, back to John. John won them over. John convinced them, and boy, did he have a lot riding on the line at that moment, only the entire nation's ambitions in space riding on the idea that he had come up with. But not everybody agreed with him. And let's go back to this person again. So I mentioned before that he, Wernher von Braun, was one of the strongest endorsers of the direct ascent method, the battleship, the Battlestar Galactica. This gentleman did something quite remarkable at this moment. He changed his position. After listening to John and his supporters, he publicly, and granting credit everywhere it was due, reversed his position and said, this is the right way to go. And I want to draw attention to that because it takes remarkable courage and remarkable tolerance for risk to be the person that everyone looks to and to say, I was wrong, and now we're going to do it the right way. I think I respect him more for that than I do for pretty much anything else he did. That's something we're going to come back to in just a moment. That's the end of my second story, the Apollo program. And it was about risk. It was about the preconceived notions we have about risk and the tolerance of risk being essential for agile thinking. And by the way, if you study the Apollo mission a little bit more, you'll find numerous examples of a very agile mindset in the creation of that project. It's something that I very much want to see restored to the agency today, because I believe that agility was essential to our success and is something that we have in short supply today. But we're working on it. So for the third part of my presentation, I'm going to talk about what I think is the third pillar of agile thinking, which is commitment. Or rather, taking care not to grow overcommitted too soon in a project. Now, I know that a lot of us are working on projects that feel like this, probably most of the time, a sea of options, many different challenging decisions, and no shortage of people standing there right beside us reminding us of the risks we take when we change something. It's kind of funny, right? You know, people seem to really get this risk of change. If you go through that door and you're wrong, you could bankrupt our company. If you go through that door and you're wrong, you could lose your job. For some reason, the risk of change is something extremely palpable and well understood, but I want to point out that the risk of not changing, while greatly, well, much more subtle, is every bit as serious. Now, I'm sure we all wish we had the kind of vision that I was talking about earlier in this talk, that we could look at those sea of doors, all those options, and say, that one, that is the door for success. That is the path, that's the telephone. That's the lunar orbit rendezvous method for Apollo. That's the way we need to go, and I guarantee it, we're gonna win if we go down that path. And then we could charge through that door. We could be courageous. We could embody so many of those terms that we read about in Agile books. However, I think that that kind of vision is something of an illusion. I don't think it exists, and I don't think that the people I've talked about today had that kind of vision or that kind of tolerance for risk. I think that they were essentially the kinds of people who could do this, meaning that they could explore many paths a little bit and hold back the fundamental investment, the thing that brings you to, for Bell's case, to the brink of, you know, death by exhaustion, or to John's case, the willingness to place the entire nation's ambitions in space all on the back of one design. Holding back that investment as long as possible before it is clear which is the best way. In other words, you've got your silver bullets and you don't spend them, you don't shoot them until you're confident about the path that you're going down. And the thing is that this isn't just my opinion, because these great people tell us that this is the way that they worked. The only exception that I've studied, that I've been able to find, is Nikola Tesla. But all these folks tell us that they operated in a highly parallel, highly experimental method that allowed them to accomplish the success. Now, this is really important for us as software practitioners, software engineers, software leaders, because we happen to work in a field and build with materials that are the most flexible of anything on Earth, pure thought almost, the kinds of stuff that lets us try out 5 different ideas in an afternoon. So it fascinates me, actually, that there are people in the software community who want to take that most valuable quality of software away. Doesn't make much sense. It's what makes it, among other things, what makes it special. So, one thing we've learned to do in our work at NASA, and I'm sure many of you have too, is that when we're presented with a really tough problem, and we're tempted to ask this question, because hey, we're engineers, right? This is what we do. How can I build this thing? Nope, ask this question. Because if you can, you can find something open source, if you can find something to inherit, if you can find some way to delay a little bit, safely, the fundamental step of commitment. You don't have to have superhuman vision. It's a careful card game. In software, we can change and refactor and reform in seconds. There's no metal to cut, no wires to run again. Our products are made of materials of thought, and we have to embrace that. So I'm going to close now and remind you of one of those important quotes. You're attending a very important kind of gathering. Gatherings like this are essential to us as practitioners. They're also essential to our community because it helps it move forward. I hope you will take the opportunity offered by this gathering to leave the beaten track, dive off into the woods, and come back and share with the rest of us what you discover. Thank you very much. I'd be happy to take questions.
Jeff, thanks so very much. Before we take some Q&A, we have just a couple minutes for that. Let me make a quick announcement. At 10:15, we reconvene And at that time, the conference is split. We'll have the Better Software Conference going on. We'll have the Agile Development Practices Conference going on. Remember that as a delegate, you can pick and choose. You don't have to, you know, if you signed up for one, you can certainly go to sessions for the other. All right? And so then we won't see you back here in a block until tomorrow morning for next for tomorrow's keynote. Any questions for Jeff that you'd like to pose? We have some folks with microphones running around. If you'd raise your hand, and we'll try and get a mic to you.
I believe from the virtual participants. I thought, maybe not. Oh, okay.
Thank you, Jeff. You've captivated the virtual conference delegates with your wonderful presentation. They're dying to know, what technology did you use, and is this a NASA thing?
No, it's not a NASA thing. It's something that I've had a lot of fun playing with. I work in human-computer interaction, so I'm always excited about anything that's about people interacting with systems. So that's augmented reality. I used the AR toolkit, which is an open-source augmented reality toolkit. To be exact, for those of you who care, I'm actually using a Java port of that called NIAR toolkit, and then a helpful person out there created a wrapper around that makes it quite easy to use in processing. And so processing is a Java-based development environment that really makes it very straightforward to build graphically intensive applications like the one that I was showing there. And so the code is actually really very simple. It's I wish I could say I had some like fundamental eureka on building that. It was a lot of fun, but wasn't too challenging to build. So NIAR toolkit, which is a Java port of AR toolkit, and inside processing. And the markers come with AR toolkit. These are actually my business cards, but those are easy to come across. Any other questions? Yes, in the front there.
Hello. With all the recent cutbacks that NASA is now going to be experiencing, you're in our playground now. Most projects get cut back before they end, and you have no money. So how are you going to build the next spaceship with no money?
I'll begin by saying that is a question which is just a little bit above my pay grade. talk to our senators and Congress people and our president. First of all, I will say it is actually not a new problem for NASA. NASA has faced budget challenges many times. I've talked to people. I remember meeting a guy who had worked at NASA for a couple decades and had been on numerous canceled projects. And while canceled projects are sometimes a very sad and frustrating thing, sometimes you cancel projects because you've discovered the right thing to do. And you set aside the wrong idea and you go to the right idea. So some cancellations are normal, but sure, like anybody, I don't like to see the reductions in budgets that the future may bring. I'll say that I work in the field of robotic space exploration. So you might realize, for instance, that the Jet Propulsion Laboratory alone has 18 robotic spacecraft and instruments up right now. And my organization operates 15 of them. There's a lot going on out there in robotic space exploration. And I think a real promise for continuing to extend human understanding about the universe in the years ahead. And I think that I'm very hopeful that we will continue that progress unabated. I'll mention, just in a matter of days, this month, the launch window opens for the Mars Science Laboratory rover Curiosity, which is an amazing machine that dwarfs in almost every way, size, complexity, science return, the rovers that we have there today, one of which is still operating quite excitedly. So, I remain optimistic, perhaps cautiously, for the future. Yes? Someone, Mike?
Yeah. Thanks for a very good talk, Jeff.
Thank you.
My question is NASA experimenting with agile software development?
Absolutely. So,
can you say more about it?
Sure. So I lead an organization of about 150 people. It's about half software. It's half people who use our software to command the missions. And I am a huge believer in agile methods. And so we have in that organization today 6 Scrum teams working. We have a lot of people following agile practices that are a little more resemblant of They resemble XP a bit more. And, you know, I get that question a lot, actually. I got it, it's interesting, about 10 years ago, I got the question about the use of open source software within NASA. And at the time, we were using a lot of open source packages in the system that would ultimately operate the Spirit and Opportunity Mars rovers. And people would ask us, you know, what are you doing? You know, how can it be safe to do that? You know, you didn't write that code. And I had to explain many times, and it's nice that I don't actually have to explain this that often anymore, that actually it made our software safer because we had the benefit of experts working on systems that supported our software in ways that, and with a level of expertise that we couldn't hope to accomplish. Now, I think the story with agile development is following a similar pattern. I get a lot of questions right now about, you know, how is it safe to follow an agile practice in mission critical development? And my answer is always that it makes it safer. I really believe that. The reason why it makes it safer is that we are much more likely to build the right thing. For me, that's the biggest risk that I worry about up front. Yes, testing is important. Yes, you know, quality control has an extremely important role in the project. But building the wrong thing, there's no amount of testing that fixes that. And agile methods make it much more likely to stay on target for that, especially in a business like mine, where we're doing a lot of things for the very first time. Expecting anyone, myself or other project leaders at NASA, to have the kind of vision to know exactly what needs to be built and write some gigantic requirements document, design document, and then just build it the first try is ludicrous. We're not that good. None of us are. So agile methods allow us to make the course corrections along the way that help us succeed. So I'm a big believer of it. It is spreading rapidly, both within the Jet Propulsion Laboratory and at other NASA centers, and I think that'll continue. Another question from the virtual audience. Happy to talk, by the way, with anyone more about that one. I obviously am passionate about it and probably could talk about it for a whole another hour.
Thanks, Jeff. This person asks, at some point, you must commit to an idea and proceed with attempting to develop the solution. So what's the best way to identify you've done enough research to make sure your decisions are correct? And then the second part to that question is, how do you prevent yourself from overcommitting to software projects?
Well, so it's as if the first part wasn't hard enough. So that's obviously a really tough problem. And I have to say that while I do believe in the role of process and the documentation of how we work, I'm also a very, very big believer in people, experts, who train and learn how to do things. And I guess this is part of the Agile Manifesto, to value people over process. That is a judgment, right? And it's a judgment that is hard to make right, and organizations must recognize the people who know how to make that kind of a judgment, promote them, and support them. Because I think what's happening there is that there's this incredibly complicated, non-linear process going on in our brains when we make a decision like that. There are hundreds, if not thousands, of factors that are being weighed. And if you think that you can make like a pro and con list or some spreadsheet model that is going to compare with the non-linear processing power of the human brain, you're just kidding yourself. It might make you feel good to look at some spreadsheet and say, look, our, you know, maturity score is 9, and so therefore it's the right way. We've done enough, you know, work. No. In the end, I would much rather trust a trained individual or small group of individuals to make that call. So I'm afraid I don't have a formula. I feel that the tendency of people is to overcommit too soon, and so we may want to try and correct for that a little bit and try to delay the fundamental commitment. But I cannot offer a great formula. And so that for the second part of that question, I think that's trying to answer that as well, meaning that, you know, how do you try to avoid becoming overcommitted? Well, I mean, part of it is, I'll go back to the open source point. Part of the reason why we incorporate open source so much in the systems that my organization builds now is that we had two realizations. One, the systems that we were trying to build far larger than our budgets. And two, that there were people out there who were dedicating their lives to building, say, a great GUI infrastructure or a great update mechanism or a great XML parser or a database, you know, relational mapping, you know, one of many components. And they were well beyond our expertise in those particular areas. I like to tell people about understanding what your rocket science is, all right? So happens that our rocket science is actually rockets, but everybody has rocket science, meaning that if you have devoted your time to building an object relational database mapping, that's your rocket science, and you should be trying to use open source and the community for everything except that, and I'm going to do the same thing, and I really depend upon you to stay focused on what you're doing so I can focus on what I'm doing. So I would say that's one way to try to avoid becoming committed too early, is that you try to stand on the shoulders of experts building things that enable what you do, because it allows you to save your money and save the commitment that you are going to make for your rocket science, for the thing that matters most to your organization. Yes. We'll get to you in 1 second. Hey.
Hello. So I'm a real big believer in the philosophy you're talking about in terms of refactoring often, move fast, break things. I believe, but then again, I work mostly in software services. I could deploy 10 times a day and the users don't get a choice. They get the new bits and I get it out there right away. Mm-hmm. I sometimes get pushback from folks that are working in box product or more conventional type software, which sounds like a lot more of what, you know, you're not working on box product, but you're working on more of that kind of where you don't get to deploy 10 times a day. So what do you do and what advice would you give to those folks that push back on that philosophy?
Well, first thing I would say is we're, you know, within my business, very much moving towards service models for our applications as well, meaning that, you know, we see the benefits that you see, which is that, you know, if I'm not installing some behemoth of an application that then I have to, you know, go and reinstall whenever I make a change, that's a big benefit for us. So we're on our way to web applications. I'll say that even with the big behemoth applications long ago, we started making those, you know, all self-updating because, you know, we needed to be able to have some of the agility associated with being able to do releases quickly when we needed to, and to make sure we had consistency among everybody who was using the software. When it comes to box products, well, I'll come back to mission critical here again. There are a lot of people in this audience who build systems upon which human lives depend. I met a fellow from Sandia yesterday, works with systems that are associated with nuclear testing. There are a lot of places where it's critical not to make a mistake. I bet you a lot of you people, if you make a mistake in an update, whether it's a box product or not, could bankrupt your company. That's pretty mission critical, suddenly being out of a job in this economy. So I'm not going to say, I'm very quick to point out that NASA simply doesn't have a patent on critical thinking and critical work, but we'll hopefully have a few lessons. So I would say that we do place a lot of attention on, you know, testing and care before we make an update. We're also very big believers in being able to jump back, Jack, the moment that we realize we've done something wrong. So every release plan has a abort plan. Every upload of spacecraft software has a fault tree, a plan B. You know, every spacecraft has a safe mode that guarantees that we can maintain the basic systems and support the spacecraft even if we've messed everything else up. Hopefully that answers a few of the questions that you might have had. Yes?
Jeff, I find it interesting because a lot of people actually use mission critical or NASA or other things as case studies for why you should do waterfall, or just because it's critical and you have to do this in a waterfall way. So at NASA, do you have a lot of people who have that waterfall mindset that we have to, you know, figure everything and analyze everything up front before we begin? And if so, how do you get them to think in a different way and get to that agile thinking that you like?
Yes, of course. And honestly, I think we have that in spades at NASA. I think a lot of that thinking, by the way, comes from the infancy of software. When software started to be used in my agency or anywhere else, all we could turn to were the work practices that had governed things like the building of hardware. And in hardware, I actually think that some parts of the waterfall approach actually make some sense, because there, the cost of change is extremely high late in the process, meaning that if I have to cut metal again, or if I have to retool manufacturing as a result of some aha that I had late in the process, that's very expensive. And so I think when those people who were more accustomed to building hardware, or when we started wrapping wires around things to make software, and then ultimately actually, you know, started to write real software. Boy, I hope I didn't insult the people who wrapped the wires. Anyway, that when that transition happened, they turned to what they knew. They turned to the work practice that was familiar, which had served them. Unfortunately, we've made a major transition in the capabilities of software today. And that transition continues. Things like refactoring and frequent refactoring is a modern invention. And surprise, it requires a completely different way of thinking about work practice. So that's what I start by telling people in NASA who say, you know, we use a waterfall and we're not really so sure about what you're doing. The next thing I try to explain to them, those stakeholders upon which a lot of risk is riding, is I try to show them how they will gain control over the system, because I believe most people, when they look at an agile practice, they fear that they're losing control. There's this sort of cowboy thing going on, and that it's going to go off without them being able to control it. And the waterfall seems much safer, meaning that I can write it all down, and then I can yell at you if you don't do what was written down. That feels better. Of course, I mean, I think we all recognize the fallacy of that, because what you wrote down will quickly become wrong, and you would actually end up getting yelled at if you had done what the waterfall did. So I can point to lots of projects that followed waterfall but didn't build what was actually written down. They just never bothered to own up to that. I try to explain to those people that they will actually gain control, more control than they had in waterfall. That helps with a lot of people. That's one of my favorite things to remind them. Once you've got a few successes under your belt, it really helps. And I don't know how we're doing on the clock, so I hope someone will tell me when we're...
3 minutes.
Okay.
First, thanks for a great presentation.
Thank you.
I have a question regarding something that, from the stories that you told, they're basically heroes, not teams. And my question is, first of all, what do you take from, if there's some kind of a team aspect from these stories? And the opposite question, if we work with teams, we know they work. Without this kind of leadership, are these teams going to fail?
Well, so I feel like I've done you a disservice, because it's true I focused on some heroes here, but these were the creation of teams. So, I mean, for instance, I didn't even have a chance to talk to you about Watson, of course, Alexander Graham Bell's faithful assistant, who had all of the implementation knowledge necessary to realize the telephone. So again, Alexander Graham Bell didn't really understand electricity all that well. He needed an electrician. That was Thomas Watson. They were an amazing two-person team. And then, of course, we have the fact that, you know, there was Mabel, there was Gardner, there were other people involved there. And, of course, Apollo required a civilization to build. So a team of the scale that few of us have ever seen. Experts of every stripe and color. And I'll take just this moment to point out another thing that I believe is really important about that, which is that as the systems that we build grow in complexity the way that they did for Apollo, we need heroes, we need leaders. What we really need most of all is specialists working together. So Plato actually tells us that civilization comes from the need, the result of people who specialize and cooperate, okay? And there's a fundamental fact in there, which is that if I can focus, so from like a hunter-gatherer perspective, if I can focus on gathering the food and you can focus on taking care of you know, the young people in the camp, then together we make a much stronger whole than if both of us were having to do everything ourselves. So modern software has reached a level of complexity where we must all specialize. If you go back 20 years or so, you might be able to find software systems built entirely by one person, that the complexity was under control by one person. Obviously, that's not true today. So I would say when I look at modern projects and how teams of people work together, I feel that Apollo was a great example. I believe even Alexander Graham Bell's story is a great example of specialization and cooperation and the essential nature of that to accomplish great things. I'm sure if you look at your own organizations, you should see this, and if you're not, I would recommend that you encourage it. And specialization as a leader is one important, you know, factor in that. I hope that answered your question.
Jeff, thank you very much. Our time
thank
is
you.
Up. Jeff's going to be around today and tomorrow. If you have some questions, he'd be happy to chat with you. Again, quick break time. We'll reconvene in 15 minutes. Have a great conference. We'll see you later.
Everybody here? I just wanted to thank everybody here for attending, and I wanted to remind you to visit cmcrossroads.com to see the rest of the ALM Expo presentations. Thanks. Bye.